it's a pleasure to connect with you again on the Atharva Forum. We have seen each other in nearly 1 month now.
Yeah, no, yeah, 1 month, right? Or maybe two. Yeah, February. Yeah, yeah.
So, February, when we met each other briefly.
Yeah, yeah. So, what's going on, yeah?
Nothing much. I've been tasked with grilling you about Chanakya.
Okay, it's not grilling, it's a pleasure.
I'm of course familiar with him because of the serial, because of conversation, random quotes, because of references, because of that great Amit Shah photograph with Chanakya behind him, which has become
iconic, no?
Iconic, really. Iconic, it's the history of this era.
Totally.
I'm really curious. I know there are a lot of people like that about me who are are not necessarily that well versed with the man who he is. And I was hoping that through this conversation, we will be able to discover some more things about him and understand his time, his era, his philosophy, and the relevance of it in this present day.
Okay.
So let's start. So my first question really is, of course, we are a democracy.
Mm-hmm.
We were not in the time that Chanakya lived and was alive.
Mm-hmm.
Are we a democracy in the sense that we understand it today?
Mm-hmm.
Do you think someone like him would have looked at governments or the structure of democracy as a positive thing? Or would he have been more towards the benevolent dictator or the benevolent authoritarian sort of side of the spectrum?
Okay, you want a long answer for this or a short answer?
Short, please.
Okay, so the concept of democracy is, you know, basically where people get to be their own rulers. Fundamentally, that's what democracy is. Like, you know, you elect your neighbor, you elect somebody based on his or her pitch, so to say, to use the commercial term. What are the best ideas that you resonate with that he or she brings to the table? So this is basically voting. That is voting, and that's the fundamental cornerstone of democracy. Now, when you talk about this kind of a system, whether it existed during Chanakya's time, which is roughly around 300 BC onwards. So you are essentially retrofitting something, a recent, a modern concept. I mean, the notion of democracy, both in theory and practice, is not older than 500 years or 600 years at the most. So, and even it began in fits and starts because older systems had a lot of drawbacks, you know, some really evil drawbacks. So it's a process of evolution of essentially how people come together and govern themselves. So if you retrofit this one back to them, you will obviously have some problems, but there are some commonalities in the notion, both in theory and practice, of democracy as we understand it today, in the sense that you had the system of voting in an assembly. You had something called Shreni and Sabha, which means guilds. Basically, you can roughly, you know, in using modern terminology, think how a Rajya Sabha member is elected. You know, there's a proportional kind of calculation that happens where even all MLAs have a vote and there's some kind of a formula that is evolved, which finally decides who gets to be a Rajya Sabha member. So you had some system, a similar system like that, not exactly the same thing. You had concepts of voting. For example, you would have either small coins or some kind of wooden, a round shaped thing, like which was painted in different colors, green, red, yellow, whatever. And if a decision had to be taken collectively, the color of the stone or a wooden thing, billet or something, whichever was the highest, that decision would go in that favor. So you had all these kinds of systems.
The color, stone, something.
Stone or wooden billet or something. So right. This system also existed. Then you had the sabhas, which means assembly. and decision making was collected, and this is brought out very beautifully when you, I'm sure you've seen the Doordarshan serial in Chanakya, where all this, so where all these methods of, you know, assemblies were there and decision was made collectively, although you had something called a samrat. When you say samrat, it's not, in Chanakya's time at least, it was not a monarchy in the sense that we understand it over a period of time. So this dynastical hierarchy and this dynastic succession was a much later development. So does this kind of answer your question, or have I rambled too much?
No, it does. In fact, it's fascinating to think that even in that era, we had a situation where there was a system of voting. We don't know for sure, or do we know? This is something you can answer.
No, we do know. We do know, because it's not just Kautilya's Arthashastra which mentions this. You have references to this in various Rajashastra texts on Rajashastra, that is statecraft and politics. And if you want a very good overview of this, you can read a beautiful book called Hindu Polity by K.P. Jayaswal.
Okay.
Yeah, so that mentions all these, you know, system of both commercial guilds, military guilds, and traveling guilds, and something called Sabha and Samiti. Now, when you look at the Hindi equivalents or the equivalents in Bharatiya Bhasha, for all these terms, you have Samiti, you have Sabha, you have Vidhan Sabha, right? Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, Vidhan Sabha. All these terms, why are they used? They are technical terms. And they have a history of more than, of at least 3,000, 3,500 years. The modern notion of democracy, you really can't, you know, retrofit it and make a hypothetical case on how Chanakya would view it. Okay, because let me give you a historical illustration to kind of get to this point in a little more detail. You are familiar with the term Janapadas, right? The nearest English equivalent to Janapadas are republics. So you had 16 republics, independent republics, which had well-defined borders, which had their own system of governments, like what you can call today, I'll give a random example of panchayat. Now, in the same state, you might have, say, 5,000 different panchayats, which means a panchayat for each village, which, although they are structurally the same, one panchayat will not function exactly the same as other. Because they are highly localized, there are specific rules and systems based on the village they are located in.
Right.
So you can think of these Mahajanapadas or republics in that sense. And they were independent. I don't want to use the word nation state. See, this terminological confusion, I don't want to get into, because it kind of blurs the clarity. So, but you can think of them as loosely federated republics, which had their own systems of governance, which were unique to each other, but which also had shared some common characteristics, what you call best practices. And then they also had their own military. So to that extent, yes. And these republics were essentially vote-based. There was no hierarchic succession. There were no dynastic succession. If that is what you mean by saying, whether they had democracy in the sense that we understand it. Yes, some of them had dynastic succession, some didn't have.
So they owed allegiance then to the Mauryan Empire, but they had this...
No. What I'm talking about is pre-Mauryan Empire.
Oh, you're talking about pre-Mauryan.
Pre-Mauryan Empire.
Yeah.
It is pre-Mauryan Empire. So just to give a historical context to this, Chanakya, when he saw why Alexander was able to, succeed so well,
mm-hmm.
in India. And let's not be under any illusion that Alexander invaded India. No, it was just a raid, and nobody even remembers that invasion, so to say. At the most, how far did he get? He didn't even get as far as Magadha, that is Bihar.
Mm-hmm.
Right? All maximum his impact was in the northwestern India, which we have lost today.
And Gilgit,
Balochistan, Gandhara, all these places. Yeah. Beyond that, he couldn't get. Maximum, he was walking on the doors of Punjab. That is also northwestern India, even today.
Yeah.
The point is, when Chanakya saw the reasons for the defeat, he understood that all these Mahajanapadas or republics, they were disunited. So he said, you know, he was so farsighted that he said, look, only by, you know, bringing them all together under a very powerful centralized monarchy, which also allows them to retain their age-old way of life, their traditions, their whatever social customs.
A lot of element of autonomy,
except the military. Except the military, rest they were free to do, you know, carry on their life as before. So even during the Mauryan Empire, the Janapadas were in existence, but under the Mauryan monarch. Does that answer?
Which brings me to my next question, which is really about the bureaucratic establishment, the civil administration during this time, because you would have needed that was effective, powerful, and able to coordinate between these various autonomous regions, so to speak, under the Mauryan Empire. What was Chanakya's role in ensuring that took place smoothly?
Because you have to give it to the man's foresightedness. Yeah, when he saw what he realized that it was not merely enough to have this overarching central empire, but he also saw that it needed a similarly strong administration, which was both centralized and decentralized, and which had mutual checks and balances. Now, I am not sure. I think you must have read Arthashastra, right?
Are you putting me on the spot?
No, I'm not. I'm not. It's just a question. It's a conversation. Yeah?
No, I'm not.
Okay. So the Arthashastra, I think, is one of the earliest manuals on how to organize, structure, and carry out an effective bureaucracy. There is almost a department for every single thing, and some critics, modern critics who read Arthashastra, will say that, you know, this is a maze of red tape. So there was a ministry for forests, and then there was in turn a sub-ministry for looking after elephant-only forest. There were officials who looked at, things like getting regular forest produce from what we call as tribal communities. It could be honey, it could be ivory, it could be various medicinal plants, shrubs, herbs. So you had sub-departments for that. Then we are all familiar with his spy system. I don't need to kind of elaborate on that. Then you had a highly regulated system of what we today call prostitution. It had its own separate quarters.
It was completely legalized. It was completely legalized.
Yeah, it's like, I don't want to use this analogy, but to make things clearer, it was like you go out to a restaurant and eat. So it's like that. You go to that place.
And what was the social status of women who kind of provided this service, so to speak?
They were different gradations of prostitutes. I'm not using the word in a pejorative sense, because it never had a pejorative meaning in those days. That you had ganikas, then you had nagarvadhu, for example. You are familiar with that. So these were all very, very, the words itself convey a very respectful, a kind of a dignified meaning to them. So it was a respectable and widely recognized profession, and it was not frowned upon, because they realized that it met a certain need in the society. So whether it's bad, good, whatever, that's a separate debate. But they had a highly regulated system for this. Then you also had a separate place for gamblers. In the city, in the outskirts of city, whatever, there are detailed rules for where and how these things should be structured. And all of these so-called illegal, immoral activities had a separate ministry and a separate minister to oversee them. It had a separate police who were well versed with what happens there, and they were also manned by and infiltrated by the spies of the state. Because we are familiar with it. No, most of the state secrets are sold in all countries due to honey trapping.
And I was just going to say honey trap. So
there you go.
You came up with the honey trap.
Yeah. Yeah, so honey trapping, gambling, you know, you're desperate, you lose money. All kinds of people come there, no?
Right.
Ministers, they gamble there. So they were highly regulated, and reports went out each evening to the higher authorities. Then you had separate ministries for highways, and you had different categories of highways, like Ghanta Pata, Mahapata, like different highways. Like today you can... take an analogy that national highways and state highways and village roads, you know, connecting roads, arterial roads. So you had separate divisions like that. It's a beautiful, manual for how to conduct civil administration, both military and civil.
I find this fascinating because, like I said, you know, I've not read the Arthashastra, but when you're speaking of it, it's something that's completely relatable to me as somebody who is alive in 2020. Mm-hmm. You know, sound very historic or alien or anything like that. That's I think fascinating, you know.
Yeah, then you had ministries on how to build forts and where to build forts,
right? So that would be like your defense infrastructure
so.
Things of that nature. But we've talked about the so-called debauchery side. What about the spiritual side? You know, what was there any room for spirituality? Was there a state religion? Was it kind of promoted again? In view of other faiths? What was the status of Islam, Christianity? Had that activity started? All of those things. What was it like at that time?
Yeah, fantastic question. Except that Islam came more than 2,000 years after Chanakya's death.
So India,
it's not even the realm of the question. As far as a state religion was concerned, India was not introduced to an alien faith beyond her borders. Whatever alien faiths, because even Alexander, when he came here, that was a pre-Christian world, or rather a pre-Abrahamic world. Right? So there's nothing like a state religion as such. But as long as human beings are there are divisions, you can't escape from it.
Yeah.
Right.
So what were the divisions at that time?
You had different sects. Okay. And by the time Buddhism had become ascendant during Kautilya's time, and Buddha bhikshus, there was no differentiation that because you see, like I said before, there was no single monarch who had affiliation to a particular religion.
Right.
You got it? So there's no question of state patronage to any one religion. And pretty much people were free to follow whoever they wanted, live however they wanted.
Here's my question. Like in the Western civilizations, where you have monarchs, so you look at the England, for example, and the whole thing with the royal family and the Church of England, and how at some point, they had to split away from the larger Catholic faith.
Yes.
Kind of established the monarchy in England. And a lot of the authority of the authority to rule British monarchs came from being guardians of the Anglican Church, etc., etc. In our context, you're essentially saying that, there was no such God-ordained or sanctioned blessing.
Absolutely. So
it came from... Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, so fundamentally, this is also excellent question, because you look at what are known as Abrahamic religions, okay? Everything flows from the religion. The laws, the social customs, practices, civil interactions, marriage, inheritance, widowhood, whatever, divorce, everything comes from a single book, right? So it could be the Christian holy book or later in Islam from the Quran and the Hadiths. However, we had a separate what was called demarcation, like keep each thing in its own place and a place for everything, right? So you could not allow the dictates of some sect to prevail upon civil laws.
And Manu came later as well, right?
Manu came much before. But let's not get into that because it's only going to put you in more confusion.
Okay.
So the point is, what you understand as religion or religious texts was completely separate from what is known as civil laws and criminal laws. So these laws came from Dharma Shastras. The king would rule not based on what Shiva said or Vishnu said or what some Tirthankar said or some Buddhist monk said. He wouldn't rule by that. He would rule and dispense justice and give punishment based on what was written in the Dharma Shastras.
That kind of became the secular book of that era?
If you want to use that word secular,
yes. You want to use the word, I know you don't like it, but...
No, I mean, it causes unnecessary confusion for a topic to which it doesn't apply.
Okay.
That's all.
It was the book that was kind of applicable across the
Dharma,
board.
Yeah, Dharma Shastras. Yeah.
And
not even across the board, actually. If you look at Dharma Shastra texts, right, you have literally thousands of them. And if you compile all of them, in terms of the number of printed pages, they come up to 70 lakhs.
My God.
Okay. So, and not all Dharma Shastras were applicable universally. Like what was known as Dharma, what was regarded as Dharma in, say, Haryana, would not be applicable in what is known as what was known as Dharma Shastra in practice in Maharashtra. Right?
Incredible diversity.
So what was known as Deshachara and Kulachara. So Deshachara means those customs and practices and traditions which are specific to a particular locality, like Haryana or Karnataka. Right. Kulachara is that which comes to you as a family inheritance.
As a kul. Huh?
As a kul.
Yes. So
these two were the touchstones for deciding, you know, what constituted dharma in your daily life, in practice. Now, inheritance law would be completely different for, say, a kayast and for a Brahmin. And everything was documented meticulously, which is why we had these 70 lakh pages of these Dharma Shastras.
You see, what I also recall of what I studied in school, actually, of the Mauryan Empire, there was a lot of building of temples and architecture from that period. So that was sponsored or facilitated or received the patronage of the emperor. And was,
as far as I am aware of it, there's no substantial temple building activity during the Mauryan periods, but I could be
wrong. There was more infrastructure, more...
The temple building activity actually... is an outgrowth of the Yagna system. But that's, I think we can do a separate podcast on this. We're digressing.
Okay. This is, let me now get to my next question. Because this is absolutely fascinating, Sandeep. Thanks for bringing that world alive to us in 2020.
My pleasure.
Under the lockdown. Now going back to Chanakya. Now, according to him, acharyas had to be at the top of the hierarchy. Because the colonized Indian mind, we may understand the importance of this system.
Okay, a couple of nuances in this. All pre-industrialized societies had a hierarchy. Okay. Now, hierarchy in terms of what you call governance, social structures, systems, practices, traditions, all that, right? Now, when you say acharyas were at the topmost of the hierarchy, now you would, what were they? They were like every minister has advisors. You could look at acharyas as something equivalent. I'm just giving a very, very, very generalized, very, very broad kind of an analogy to this. So they would essentially guide the king in decision making, in making sure that the king doesn't become a despot. Okay, so there is a beautiful
moral compass
also. So and these acharyas had to be above board. Okay, there is a beautiful shloka, beautiful verse in Mudra Rakshasa based on Chanakya's life, where it describes the lifestyle of Chanakya. And it's a beautiful, as a literary device also, it's beautiful. It is said through in the mouth of Chanakya's disciple. So who shows Chanakya's house to Chandragupta Maurya, who has now become the emperor. He says, what can you do to such a man? Look at his house. He lives in a mud hut which will fall any time. And what are his possessions? What is his wealth? Dried cow dung, which he uses to perform Agnihotra every day, 3 times a day. And a straw mat on which he sleeps, or just on the bare mud ground that he sleeps. One dand, which he uses for walking, and the clothes he wears. What can you do to such a man? So this was the real status of acharyas in those days. So you want to, the whole point is, the most brilliant and the most learned person has to voluntarily adopt a life of poverty. Or a simple life at any rate.
Or austerity.
So if you want to, put them, when you say, they were supposed to be at the top of the hierarchy, it is because they had earned it through this means.
So was he the first among equals when it came to acharyas, or was there a council of acharyas? How was it arranged?
Okay, there are different, categorizations. Very good question, actually. Different categorization. You had council of ministers. You could call them acharyas. Eventually, they would be called, technical term is mantri or amatya. Okay, acharyas were typically like a spiritual guru who also, they did not interfere in the administration, but they ensured what you said, moral compass, that, listen, you might be this emperor, this great guy who everybody bows down to, but there is something above you. And that is not me, that is Dharma. So during the coronation of any emperor, at the time of coronation, a wooden stick would be beaten on the head of the king 3 times, saying Raja Dharmiko Bhuyat, meaning king, you should always be a votary of Dharma. You should uphold it. It is beating him on the head that ki, you remember this.
Yeah.
Always this is above you.
Right.
So when you talk about hierarchy, these nuances will be missed, is what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. Because the notion of what you call ruling a subject, ruling a country or kingdom or whatever, was that Raja had to be a Praja Vatsala, meaning he had to earn the affection of people. So when we talk about, last mile delivery of governance, whatever systems, structures, design, and all these new terms, which I don't understand, essentially, where is that missing element that gives a direct one-to-one emotional bond between the highest person in the country and to the last person? That bond is affection.
To be loved. More than fear.
To earn it,
You have to earn it,
yeah.
The reverse of, I guess, the West Chanakya, which is Machiavelli.
No. That is the worst analogy you can give. Machiavelli is the equivalent of Chanakya in the West or whatever.
I think I have offended you.
No, you haven't offended me. Nothing offends me.
Because of this colonial system, now that we're talking about the West, Indians are sort of thought of as only as priests. However, in Dharma, we see them as acharyas, gurus, who impart shastra vidya, who are, like you said, moral compasses of leaders and kings. What do you think is their role in democracy?
It's a largely, how do I say it? Times have largely changed. I don't know. If you ask me, an equivalent system of that should be there in every country and not just in India. The point is, when you say all these, you know, acharyas, gurus or whatever, they were just a priestly people. At the minimum, it smacks of ignorance because you can't broad-base them and, you know, categorize them into these watertight compartments, because broadly speaking, and if you are talking in terms of Brahmins, right? At the top level, you can categorize them broadly into two sections, divisions. One is the Vaidika Brahmanas and the other is the Laukika Brahmana. Vaidika Brahmanas are what you call gurus and preceptors, those who engage in you know, puja in temples,
Vedic running,
Vedic thing, run gurukuls and officiate rituals and all that. The other are the Laukika Brahmanas. They engage in what is known as worldly or secular activity. Even teaching, which consciously, where the teacher consciously takes money for imparting knowledge, which is supposed to be a sin traditionally. So, but even a teacher who is a Brahmin who takes money for imparting knowledge is considered slightly lower in the rung, because he's polluting by bartering or selling knowledge. Okay, then you have all these ministers who are also Brahmins who engage in administration, whatever. They are complete. See, anything which takes you away from the path of spirituality is essentially considered inferior and slightly sinful in the Indian lore, and they do not necessarily need to be Brahmins as such. Let me also clarify that.
I understand. That was the Varna system, not as we understand it today. I also want, you know, I'm curious. I keep bringing you back to 2020, but I think it'll just kind of liven it up for a large section of our audience, which are kind of in the same, not scholars like you, but, you know, in the same team like I am. You know, this sort of accusation of, in terms of, you know, there being an environment of anti-intellectualism. What you've spoken about right now has been about intellectualism of that era and how it was organized to a certain extent, how it was acknowledged, respected, you know, and had a place in society and governance. In today's era, the counter argument is that there is an anti-intellectualism. There is a quality or a commentary that says, you know, the eminences, whatever they may be. And it's not only in India, it's like a global phenomena, you know, where reaction against this. How do you think Chanakya would have responded to this era of anti-intellectualism?
Okay, wonderful. Quite a challenge. Very smart. Okay. Look, what you call as intellectualism is a very, 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 very recent phenomenon. Like I said, the world, the pre-industrial era world, we have completely lost even the remote knowledge of the daily life of that world. Unless you go into that level of detail, you'll just be scratching, you know, some superficial things. So there were no intellectuals in the sense that we understand and use the word today.
Okay.
It was a highly, highly...
They were scholars?
They were scholars. They were... look, even in the West and India, let's take the West today. Okay. What was the shortest route for someone becoming, you know, respectable or powerful in the West? Robber barons. Right?
What did you say?
What was the shortest way to become powerful in the West? Powerful, respected, and feared.
Right.
By becoming a robber baron.
Yes. Okay.
The king would say, okay, dude, you know, don't disturb this part of my country. You know, I'll call you a baron or a duke or a count or an earl or whatever. You ensure that you take care of this, and so that your people are in peace, don't loot them. And, you know, you give me services, send your army or whatever, your thugs, if I want them in war or something.
Right. So you're going aristocracy now.
Aristocracy, right? So this was the system, and even in the West, education, as in reading and writing and thinking, was the privilege and the preserve of the top of the top,
right?
Even in the West. I mean, these are all, take this guy for example. Who was that fellow? Yeah, famous essayist. What's his name? I used to read that in school. No, English guy, Viscount somebody.
I can't help you there.
Francis Bacon.
Bacon, yeah, right.
Yeah, so Francis Bacon was royalty, semi-royalty. He was a Viscount.
Mm-hmm.
So these were the titles of, total aristocracy. Education was close to the rest of the people.
Mm.
So there was no, this proliferation. Now, intellectuals as a separate breed is a very, very recent phenomenon. It largely happened. Hello, what?
It's been democratized in a sense.
It's been democratized. So post-industrial revolution is when all these things, began to emerge. So if Chanakya was alive and he saw all these people, let me turn this question on its head, okay? The modern system, especially the post-industrial era, has ensured that no Chanakyas will ever be born.
Why do you say that?
Damn simple, yeah. Look at it. In the previous days, even in the last century, okay, you could somehow make an honest living. Today, you spend more than 60% of your day trying to make a living.
Mm-hmm.
In various forms. You could be a freelance guy, you could be a corporate worker, vice president, whatever, designation doesn't matter. The bottom line is, you spend more than 60% of your day earning a living. And what happens when you grow old, when you're 60, 65? Think about the implications. I'm just leaving this question floating in the air. I mean, just like food for thought. This was never the case even 100 years back. Mm-hmm. And I've seen it when I was growing up, used to go to my village, different villages and all that. It was damn simple. Yeah? Money as in currency, coins and notes. The notion of money as having some kind of a great importance did not even occur to people in the villages. They would say, okay, hey, listen, yeah, this time the harvest is, very bad. So what I'll do is I'll give you 10 kgs of atta this time to you. And, you can square it off 3 months later. The notion of, they would call it paisa, paisa meaning coin, a metal coin. It never had a big importance in our psyche and in our daily life. That link is totally cut at the level of society, at the level of our psyche itself.
My help comes from a small village in Madhya Pradesh.
Yeah.
And he was chatting today and I was asking him about how his family is holding up in the village. He lives in a small village.
Mm-hmm.
And they've completely sealed the village and are existing on exactly what you're saying, the barter system.
Yeah.
Very self-sufficient.
Yeah.
Run out of tea and sugar.
Which they're,
But in terms of food and everything else,
they've
set up the system and it's working perfectly fine for them. So almost like in a post-COVID world, we may be revisiting these things again.
Sorry,
we haven't.
No, you froze a little. Can you repeat that?
I said in a post-COVID world, we may be visiting these concepts again in a way that we never thought we would. Because, going by just talking to him, he's completely secure in how his family is and, how they're dealing with the present circumstances for that tea and sugar.
Yeah, there you go. See, the notion of stress is a modern invention, in the sense that we urban people understand it. That, COVID is a lockdown, is a stress and all that. We used to be locked down when I was growing up. This lockdown was almost perpetual on a daily basis. You finish your stuff and,
Where?
Here only, Bangalore.
Where was the lockdown a perpetual thing?
No. What I'm saying is that what we call today as a lockdown was a way of life.
That, oh,
like what you call itna, we live a life of bhagdod, what you call bhagdod, right?
That's true.
So that is why we're feeling imprisoned. That's all.
Agree. Thank God for the internet, really. I come back to the conversion and those kind of activities, which did apply in Chanakya's time, but do in the present era. You know, we do have a situation wherein we see a lot of conversion and, you know, a lot of it, most of it actually is not a matter of conscience. If it is, there's no problem with that. A lot of it is through bribery, through coercive, through misleading, all of those things. Now, Chanakya, like you told us earlier, didn't have to really deal with this aspect of society because predated these faiths except for Buddhism. How do you think he would have dealt with it today?
Look, okay, damn simple. There may multiple ways I can answer this, but fantastic question, actually. The point is, he ensured that the top levels of bureaucracy, administration, were almost ruthless in their loyalty to the country. Right? And they
saw that.
And they had to pass through some 7 or 9 tests before they could be even kind of considered for appointments. And out of these 7 or 9 tests, even if they failed 3, they would still be selected, but at a very, very junior level. Because the higher you go and the more evil you are, the your potential to cause damage to the country, to its social fabric, religious harmony, your potential to cause damage to that grows exponentially.
No.
So these conversions, look at the period from 2004 and 14. The top levels of your bureaucracy and administration were completely compromised. It was a government by NGOs.
Foreign funded NGOs.
So you put such people, you know, they were not even answerable to Mr. Manmohan Singh. He was a prime minister of this country, for God's sake.
Wow.
So if look at the amount of damage that they've caused, it's everywhere, right? I mean, we don't have to, I mean, it's visible everywhere. It's consequences. We are suffering. So Kautilya would, he had preempted all this. One and two, it was a very well-oiled system. Now, you mentioned about, I think I forgot answering a previous question about, you know, how he would deal with spiritual people and all that, right? So I'll link it to this one here. Is that he would have polis in our terminology to regularly monitor sadhus and sannyasis from who would come from neighboring states. That is outside the Magadha kingdom. And there is a word in Hindi which you're familiar with, Pashandi. Right? So what is the meaning of Pashandi? Pashandi is a dongi sannyasi. He is a fake Baba in our terms, right?
Oh, Pakhandi.
Ah, Pakhandi. Yeah. It used to be called Pashanda. That's a technical term in Sanskrit. So you call it Pakhandi. So
Pakhandi.
Fake Babas and all these sannyasis. He would monitor even their activities because they would more than, there was a high degree of possibility that they would also be spies in disguise.
So, but in this era, then it would be called religious intolerance, wouldn't it?
Yeah, but we have allowed that discourse to poison us. It's our fault. As simple as that.
You know, it would be very clearly be listed under like some sort of majoritarian
Look, all power comes from how you can, not just survival, how you can hold your own. What happens in a schoolyard, right? You know, bullied versus bully. It's a universal principle, yeah, everywhere.
True. What are the similarities do you find? Actually, before I ask that question, I want to go back to your previous question because I think that's very significant because we often find this in our times at least, where the national identity of being Bharatiya or being Indian, whatever you want to call it, subservient to sometimes a linguistic identity, sometimes a regional identity. Very often, you were seeing it even this in this COVID era, a religious identity, where you know, you feel the need that this assertion of a certain group identity is more important than the nation. Now, he, from what you've told us, did administer a very diverse country. We're probably even more diverse now. How do you think he was able to even, okay, the exams are well and good. We have a civil services exam here also. But how do you inculcate a strong national identity in the individual, which overpowers these other kind of special interests that exist amongst all of us? The Americans have done it with the big American dream and all, et cetera, the greatest country in the world and Hollywood.
U.S. American exceptionalism and all that.
Exactly. How are we going to do this? To survive?
Yeah. What happened, unfortunately, in independence era, the amount of post-independence era, the amount of damage that we have caused to our own identity has been far greater and on a very larger scale than anything that happened in the preceding 800 years.
Why do you say that?
That is because of what you call mental and psychological colonization on the part of the ruling class.
Because colonialism technically was over in 47.
Yeah, but the deep-rooted, the psychological roots were there, no? So when that psychology, when those roots translated into government policies, this is what happens. The so-called, so much, you know, the whatever you want to call it, caste system, which was so abused and whatever it is, right? There was what you call caste. I won't use that word. There was Varna, but there was no casteism.
Yes.
Got it? There was no ism to that.
Varnas also.
There was a lot of mobility. There was a lot of mobility. Yeah.
Social mobility, which we have even today.
Yeah, which we have hardened.
Into kind of these sides.
Hardened because on the one hand, you say you're secular. You say that hum jatiya teet hai, hum jati ke ateet hai. On the other hand, you have, why do you create caste vote banks then? If you're beyond caste, if you've transcended caste, why do you appeal, you know, for votes from specific caste groups, caste leaders? So unless you didn't, look, education was a big failure after, you know, decolonizing Indian education. And I keep repeating this on different forums. That was the biggest failure. After we attained independence, and no sub-identity, sub-group identity, group identity, linguistic identity, none of them should take precedence over national and cultural identity, which is undeniably Hindu even today.
Hindu today is what you're saying.
Yeah, whatever you want to call it, Hindu Rashtra, whatever. If that is the meaning of Hindu Rashtra, so be it.
So then, I mean, what I've learned from our discussion so far is that Chanakya in his era also was governing a very, it wasn't homogenous, the population
dealing
with at all. And, you know, that's sort of an accusation that is often levied about Atita in that sense. But in today's era, what are the similarities and the challenges that you find between Chanakya's time and today?
So, well, I mean, as far as Chanakya's time was concerned, we didn't have the twin colonizations of Islam and British rule. That was largely absent because those two religions are fundamentally opposed to Hinduism. In Chanakya's time, every single panth and sect that emerged from this soil are all Hindu. You want to call it Buddhism, Jainism, Shakta, Vaishnava, Shaiva, whatever you want to call it. All of them emerged from this soil. And so they do not share, and so they share a lot of commonalities with homegrown religions, so to say. Both of these faiths, Islam and Christianity, essentially are predatory religions, because both of them thrive on numbers for their growth and sustenance. Otherwise, why do you need conversions? Why do you need conversions? In what you call conversions in within Hindu sects, across Hindu sects, is still okay, because for a simple reason, this kind of conversion would happen at the level of high intellectuals. Like if Mandan Mishra, I won't use a word accepted, but for convenience, I'll use a word accepted. When Mandan Mishra accepted Advaita, it was a result of a scholarly and highly intellectualized philosophical debate.
Yeah.
And which means that you genuinely...
Which is why it won eventually for him.
So, which genuinely...
That's what happened. He lost, but the wife came in and threw the kind of
gauntlet of that.
In the tail, yes.
So, which means that you are out of a sense of deep integrity. You accept philosophical defeat, which means that you are willing to let go of your ego, without which is the premise of all our Vedanta, could be Bhagavad Gita, anything that has grown here. This is the exact opposite, if not the enemy of these two predatory faiths. Why do you need numbers to grow? Yeah.
Okay, but that's conversion. Okay,
that is conversion. So Kautilya did not have to deal with this.
He didn't have to deal with this.
No. So in that sense, it was a homogeneous society. And while the Buddhists were also missionaries, they had become Buddhists after becoming Hindus, right? They were Hindus first and then they became Buddhists.
Correct. But that's the same for other faiths also.
They
were Hindus before they became Christians and Muslims.
They did not become Christians out of a philosophical debate. Christian conversion rests on three or four different, hundreds of tactics.
Correct.
Right. They'll say, if the opposition is too strong, they'll say, okay, there's no difference between Christ and Krishna. So what you're doing, it's fraud. Basically, you're cheating the other person at a very fundamental level. Or you offer money. What is that? It means you're buying people. Or the last method is violence. You convert or I'll kill you. Right?
Correct.
There's a difference, isn't it? Zameen Asman ka antar hai. So Kautilya didn't live in this society. But had he been around at the time of Islamic invasions, he wouldn't have, that is a reason he advocated for a strong central leadership, like the Mauryan Empire, a strong center with a harmonious federation of different, customs, societies, groups, units, sects.
Who stood up to this invasion?
Stood up to this as a one single unit.
I think some of the questions I've asked previously also, which has been, in terms of a national identity, how would he have changed it? Yeah. And, then of course comes capitalism. How would he have viewed our capitalistic nature? Although I think it's going to change pro-COVID, or at least I hope so.
I hope so too. I hope so too. Totally.
I think there's going to be some change.
Yeah.
How would he have, viewed this desire for profit and seeing no end to that profit and going to any extent for it. Here's one interesting one. How would he have viewed crony capitalism?
So I'll get to crony capitalism later. Let's look at capitalism. Look, capitalism, as we understand it as an economic sub-unit. So the notion of capitalism again roughly dates to around the industrial era, because capital until then was completely controlled in the royal person, in the king, monarch, whatever. He was the ultimate guy who had the keys to the treasury, although he had ministers, finance ministers, whoever it is, but they were just notional, nominal guys. Or at any rate, it was a rule of oligarchs with a central monarch who had the power to, you know, put you to death at will. So moving away from this system, when you capitalism and democracy cannot be separated. Right? Because democracy is decentralization, that is, you know, giving political power to the last person, whatever.
Including means of production.
Technically, 2024, Advaita can become the PM of India.
Not likely, but thank you.
But yeah, so the possibility exists. Right.
In a democracy.
Right. So, and how is such a system supposed to, you know, work properly, smoothly, harmoniously? With a supporting economic system, which is when capitalism came in. Right. So again, I mean, we know the history of capitalism. Eventually, it became a bunch of oligarchy, and then that also became democratized. Anybody could become, say, Azim Premji or Bill Gates or whatever. I mean, hundreds of examples. So in the sense that private individuals can aspire to and become economic powers by their own right. Right? This system was alien to Kautilya's period. So, again, this lies in the realm of hypothesis. And economics, business, money making, you know, whatever, running an economy, essentially was a very, very specialized kind of activity and skill, which was the almost the 100% domain of what are known as the Vaniks or the Vaishyas. The word Baniya comes from Vanik, Vanija, meaning business, money. So it was almost the exclusive preserve of these people. And even today we see all these people, you know, Lakshmi Mittal, all these great success stories. Why? This is in our DNA. This is in our DNA. And although the capitalism as we understand it did not exist in that time, the Indian business community is unparalleled in its genius for raising capital. They can raise capital out of thin air. I think you must have seen Mr. S. Gurumurthy's talks, some of his talks where he mentions, you know, this ability using what can be called as community guilds. In Tamil Nadu, especially, where, you know, a 17-year-old boy is propped up by the entire community too, and he goes on to found a huge bank, which is, I think, the 15th largest bank in Asia or something. It's a private bank. So hundreds of such examples. Yeah, the same thing is in the, you know, applicable to Marwadis, Gujaratis, what you call the business community.
Yeah. No, I'm running a Janta Rasoi, a community kitchen in the first, it's entirely community funded. Yeah. Mm. They're raising money for it. So,
how does it, we understand Indian business community understands the power of the third operation in arithmetic, multiplication.
Fascinating, really. Didn't think of it in these terms at all, And you know, since we discussed the Arth Shastra and you were kind enough to point out that I haven't read it.
But that said, let me complete my thought actually. Sorry. If Kautilya was there in today's capitalism, he wouldn't have allowed this kind of capitalism to develop in the first place. Now you have the four Purusharthas, right? It would go against everything that is symbolized in the four Purusharthas. The first Purusharta is Dharma. The second is Artha. The third is Kama. Fourth is Moksha. You leave out Moksha. The second Purusharta is Artha, right? Money making, business, whatever it is. On to the left, to its left is Dharma. Meaning, it has to fall within the bracket of Dharma, and on the other side, Moksha. So whatever money making you do should strictly fall within these two boundaries.
Interesting.
So because you see all these, I mean, not to offend anybody because everybody seems to be quick at taking offense nowadays. On a general point, the one thing that our Dharma Shastras strictly forbid and strictly look for is this, that more than the wealth that you earn, let's look at, take the case of some random of these huge funds, right? Private equity funds, all these venture capital, huge, massive $1 billion. They keep saying, you know, we have all these funds, right? Nobody asks them how they made that kind of money. Right? Nobody questions that. And on this point, I don't know if you have watched this beautiful series on, I think, Netflix, Mac Mafia.
No, I haven't. Yeah, I'm watching that right now.
Yeah, Mac Mafia is a good series. Only one season is over now. It's actually based on a beautiful book by the same name. It's based on the book. Okay. Watch it and check out the links between mafia money getting into these equity funds.
Into
all these super rich equity funds.
Oh, right.
Whatever funds, not just equity.
New form of laundering, I guess.
Yeah, yeah.
Any laundering.
So this is how he would have regarded capitalism.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So this comes now to the important question for me, at least. Which copy of the Arthashastra is authentic? Mm. Didn't know they got this complicated. And which one would you recommend? Because...
Several books. Actually, watch my interview on with Dr. Dwivedi on the Chanakya series.
Okay.
He gives a complete list, but generally a basic introduction and a very, very faithful translation is Arthashastra translation by Dr. R. Shama Shastri.
R. Shama?
Shama Shastri.
And it's accessible. It's
very
it's,
accessible. Very it's accessible. Not widely available. Widely available. Yeah.
Great. Thank you for that. And really, my final question is: you have said that every Hindu child must need to memorize the verses in Mudrakshasa that brings out Chanakya's character so powerfully.
Hmm.
Please explain how it is relevant today.
Yeah, I already explained. No, that. When I told you, remember that, you know, this Chanakya's disciple, he takes Chandragupta Maurya and shows his mud hut and his lifestyle. So that is the entire translation meaning of that verse.
Hmm.
So I think this is what every kid also, these are the values every child needs to be inculcated into every child is what I meant by that. I had tweeted that randomly and people just picked it up. So...
Who do you think would be Chanakya's favorite politician today?
Well, he creates politicians, so he won't have any favorite.
Who would he say that? Oh, this person is really following my lead and has read my books and is. You know?
Well, I mean, you can. Okay, if you want me to say the names, I mean, I have no hesitation in saying it could be Narendra Modi or Amit Shah. Hundreds of people are there like that. Okay. Still in the realm of hypothesis.
But you see a glimpse of some of the things that he has spoken of, showing the decision making and
the most important. Yeah, fantastic. The point with Chanakya, and this is a reason why. Great question. In fact, this is a reason why Westerners who read Arthashastra, who read Chanakya, they equated him with that scoundrel Machiavelli. Okay, there is a reason. I mean. Not harsh words. Come on. So, because they only looked at the manner in which Kautilya completely dismantled the Dhananda's empire.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there is no dirty trick he did not use in order to bring down the empire of the Nandas. Because they were fundamentally acting for themselves, for their own lineage, for their own family. At the expense of the country.
Sounds familiar.
Yeah.
I didn't take any names.
Neither did I.
Okay.
So, and they had to go. So it's damn simple. Yeah. Look, you can't be this complete scumbag. And then when the other person who fights you uses the same methods and techniques that you have perfected against you, you can't play the victim then. You can't call him, you know, he's using all these dirty tricks to bring me down. It doesn't work like that. If you had been honest, if you had been proper, if you had integrity, all these nice things, there would have been no reason to even fight you.
So my next question, it's like a rapid fire, I know, but I'm very curious. Is, you know, The Art of War, Sun Tzu, Chanakya, and Machiavelli. What's your assessment? What's your read on these three names, you know, which are bandied about around the world as being kind of these brilliant minds when it comes to...
Yeah, actually, this Art of War by Sun Tzu, right? It's quite overrated, and it became popular in the last 20 or 25 years. Before that, when I was in college and all that, these books were, you know, vaguely heard. And there's a reason it became popular, because of China's rise.
Correct.
In the world community or whatever.
Sure.
Okay, so...
Post-COVID, we're not that sure, but...
We're not that sure, yeah.
So far.
So, among all these three books, you can't compare any of them with Arthashastra. For a simple reason, because Arthashastra is a philosophy. And it is, you know, the entire essence of Arthashastra is Tasmat Shastram Idam Indriya Nigraha or Indriya Jayaha. Meaning the essence of this entire Arthashastra is self-restraint. On the part of who? On the part of the ruler. So you've heard of the famous verse, right? Dharmasya Moolam Artha, Arthasya Moolam Rajyam, Rajasya Moolam Indriya Jayaha. The root of Rajasya Moolam, the root of a kingdom or an empire, is the victory over your senses. So this is the entire essence of Arthashastra. Where is this loftiness? Where is Sun Tzu? Where is Machiavelli? There's no comparison.
Yeah. So I think basically, I mean, Chanakya would have told Donald Trump not to be on Twitter. I think.
Maybe.
Maybe, right? He would have said, get off Twitter now. But it's been wonderful speaking with you. It's certainly...
Likewise.
In which I have personally learned a lot, and I have been triggered to read on him. I have read, I have read Machiavelli.
Okay.
I have read Sun Tzu, and you're absolutely right. It comes in very easy, accessible little booklets, pretty little booklets. I might Art of War booklets with lovely calligraphy.
Yeah, a lot of calligraphy and all that.
Yes, exactly. So they're very
gold, gold lettered, embroidered, red binded.
Yes, so they're very attractive to own.
Yeah.
As usual, we haven't quite done enough for our, you know, philosophy, our history, things. So I'm very, very inspired by this conversation. And thank you so much for sparing the time.
Thank you. Thank you for having this conversation.
And making it so accessible.
I really enjoyed it.
And I look forward to chatting with you again.
Same here. Thank you.
Thank you. You
don't have to be so formal, by the way.
Sure.
Yeah, okay. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.